You're listening to Cactus.
Hi, and welcome to another edition of Cattails. Little did drummer John Coghlan know that when he joined Francis Rossi and Alan Lancaster in the newly formed band The Spectres back in 1962, his life was on course for rock stardom. The addition of Rick Parfitt, a change of name and touring strategy later, chart-topping success beckoned for Status Quo, which became one of the most successful rock bands of all time. With over 60 UK chart hits, 22 reaching the top 10, they appeared on Top of the Pops more than any other band, opening Live Aid at Wembley Stadium in 1985 and achieving a Brit Award for Outstanding Contribution to Music. Status Quo have written their place in music history. This is The One with John Coghlan.
Hello.
Hi there, John. It's Kat. How are you doing anyway? It's so lovely to speak to you again.
Yeah, it is nice. Well, you know, we've got this lockdown thing where we can't do anything because there's no gigs. Mm. And the good thing is the weather's great, so... Which is unusual for England, because, you know, sometimes it rains a lot, but we've been very lucky at the moment.
So you're out in the garden then, are you, with your feet up and your pims in your hand, or you're digging for victory with some gardening?
No, just sitting in the sun is great.
It's nice, isn't it? So, yeah, you've got no gig going on at the moment, have you? The tour has all been postponed. Any gigs you've got, you can't do. How frustrating must that be for you? Wow.
Well, really, the first two were supposed to be in Holland. There was two gigs. Go for the weekend, do two shows. That was cancelled, and the following weekend was what we call a 70s weekend. It was down in Somerset. That was pulled as well. Then everything else got pulled. So, but the good thing about it is that they've not been cancelled. They've been put up again for next year. So hopefully... You know, we'll just have to wait a bit longer, really, but that's how it's going to be, I'm afraid.
Yeah, nothing we can do about it. It's a bit of an abrupt stop to your usual lifestyle, though, isn't it? Because you've been almost touring relentlessly, been in bands for, well, crikey, all your life.
Yeah.
It must be a little bit of a shock to your system.
Well, you feel that you really are missing something, you know, and there's a big gap. There's always travelling about, and you get used to it, and you get like a rock and roll thing where you know, crew picking you up at a certain time on the road, you go to the gig, you know, check in the gig 4 o'clock, and you get into a roll of things, and it's really good fun. You enjoy it, and it becomes easy because you're doing it all the time. But then you stop doing it. It's this massive gap, you know. You think, oh, what do I do now, you know? But we're writing songs, and because we have some ideas about possibly doing something later on. But, you know, there is a big gap. But having said that, it's all the same for all musicians in the UK at the moment. Well, around the world, I suppose, about the same thing.
Yeah, and I think the music industry is really going to suffer, aren't they? Because nowadays we're really very much reliant on having the live performance to actually produce an income and to keep you promoted out there. It's going to be a hard time for a lot of people, I think.
Well, I think that's true. And also anybody in sport, I suppose, and entertainment and all that type of thing, we have to find other things to do. And also... Like you said about, you know, you're not earning any money. And fortunately for me, because of my past, I've got royalties coming in and stuff. So I am helped out, and the government helping out musicians in this country. So there is an income of some sort. But, you know, there's nothing better than going out to play a show to great Quo fans. Because my band, John Coghlan's Quo, we've got a great following of fans from the Quo stable. Mm. And they supported me in all the gigs I'm doing. And what worries me is when it all just starts again, there may be some people saying, oh, I don't know if I should go to a show, you know, go to a gathering of lots of people, still thinking it might still be the same.
Yeah, this is it, isn't it? And it's going to be a very, very different world, I think, isn't it, when we come out the other side. But, you know, obviously with all the back catalogue that you've got with Quo, how do you decide what you're going to perform? Because you've got so many songs, haven't you, from your time, your 20 years with the band. Which ones do you select and how do you do that?
Well, what we do, the thing is, we've got, as you said, loads of albums and singles. We've got a massive choice, but my band will only play stuff that I recorded, of course. And that was about 20 years worth of material. So, and we do, it's all the 70s stuff. There's quite a lot of stuff we do from we do from the Forensic Foresight, which we did, you know, the 2013 and 2014. So it's stuff that the old Crowe fans, as we put it, you know, the 70s fans, they come and hear it and they come to see us play that stuff. It's what they want. They don't want the new stuff that Francis is doing.
It's a different era, isn't it? The band, you know, Status Quo have actually got a couple of different eras. And I think that changeover with you in, what was it, 82, and then there was Alan in about 85, it really changed the sound of the band, didn't it? So I'm not surprised to hear that you've got some fans who purely like where you were with the hard sort of rock stuff rather than the more commercial, I think. They got more commercial, didn't they?
Well, I think it was the four of us. Well, it was five with Roy Lyons, of course. But then when Roy left, we carried on as a four-piece. But I just feel that the band had a chemistry at that time. But when I left, you know, 81 it was I went, and they got Pete Gershaw in, a different drummer. And so the thing is, all drummers have a different feel to the song. And unless they play a song, say like Caroline or Down Down, exactly the way I played it on the record, then it will sound different. Then, of course, John Ryan of Edwards came in, and he didn't really play like Alan Lancaster. So and that's what's happened.
Yeah, and that's the heart of the song, isn't it? And the heart of the band, really, that rhythm section. And if you change that, then it does have a different dynamic.
And also, you know, with Rick Parfitt's wonderful rhythm guitar, working with Alan and me at that time, it was a chemistry. And because Rick Parfitt, even though I've seen quite a few bands trying to copy Rick, and they play an up and down stroke on the guitar, you know, hit string down, hit string up. But what Rick used to do, he'd hit the strings on the down stroke only. So the way he attacked the song was why it worked so well. And a lot of guitarists don't know that way. They just go ding, 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 up and down strokes. It doesn't have the same feel.
No.
So that's why, you know, it's... unfortunately, my band Mick Gibbs, a rhythm guitarist, will play it as Rick played it. And it is quite hard work, but it paid off, thank God.
Yeah. Well, I suppose if they've got to adapt their style to make that sound, that must have been quite difficult for him to do that, to try and emulate what Rick was doing. But for you, you want to have that original sound, don't you? Because you were the original drummer.
Oh, yeah. Basically, Spectres and Matches made 1968. We try to keep that very similar to as it was recorded at the time. So there's a few different things we put in it because of feel and stuff, and we just change it slightly. But we try to keep everything as it originally was. Some of the songs I play drums on, the four on the floor on the bass drum. I've seen other drummers play two to the bar. Okay, it's their choice. They want to do it different, but it does, as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't have the same feel. And playing fours on the hi-hat, sometimes not doing the shuffle on the hi-hat that I play, because I grew up playing that from the old jazz bands and stuff. But, you know, it does make a difference. But, you know, we us four, JCQ, we try to keep it original as it was recorded.
Yeah, and you've got lots of people who want to hear that original sound, and so that's a great experience of almost bringing the past to life again, isn't it, when they come and see you?
Yes, yes, that's absolutely right, yeah.
So looking back to those early years then, John, you know, obviously you were a you know, a founding member of Status Quo, and that was back in, crikey, 1962-ish, wasn't it? So did it take you by surprise that actually it got so big, you got so successful?
Well, I think what happened, we released a 7-inch single in 1966, and it was called I Have Nothing. It's the song that Shirley Bassey recorded. That wasn't a hit. Hurdy Gurdy Man was released in 66. That wasn't a hit. We Ain't Got Nothing Yet, that was in 66. That wasn't a hit. Then we called ourselves the Traffic Jam for some reason. In 66, Almost But Quite Now, that wasn't a hit either. So 7-inch singles as the Status Quo was 1968, Pictures of Matchstick Men, then it was Black Bells and Melancholy, Ice and the Sun, Make Me Stay a Bit Longer, then Are You Grind Tired of My Love, 1969, there was The Price of Love in 69, then Down the Dust Bike came out in 70, then In My Chair, because what happened, Bob Young was wrote it at some point, so look, you know, because what was happening in the early days, if you didn't have a hit record, you weren't on top of the pops, you didn't really get many gigs, so, you know, Bob said, look, get rid of the frilly shirts and the baggy trousers, looking like pop stars, or whatever they called them in those days. Mm. So we grew our hair long. We got a deal with a jean company, I think. I can't remember the jeans, but Levi, I think it was, some of the, they supplied with jeans, t-shirt, grow your hair long, and it paid off. You know, we reinvented ourselves, and with a song called In My Chair, which came out in 70. So then tune to music, then Paper Plane, then Mean Girl, Gerd Nuller, I think there was Caroline, Break the Rules, Down. So, you know, endless songs coming out one after the other. It was fantastic.
That's amazing, isn't it? So do you think it was down to that change of image that, that made you appeal to more people, and that's why it changed? Or was there something in the music that changed at the same time?
Well, I reckon it's a bit of both, I think, because what happened in the early days, so we our agent, or whoever he was at the time, said, I'll put you in universities and colleges, place of the students. And so, on a Saturday night, some university, there'd be Status Quo on a Saturday night, you know, five ready to get in probably, or I don't know, whatever it was. And people say, Status Quo? Nah, they can't be playing at the university. They're a pop band, you know. Mm-hmm. Of course, they come to the gig and see us wearing jeans and long hair, heads down, boogie and all that stuff. And they loved us. They thought, wow, brilliant. The band's reinvented themselves. And that really paid off, and we just worked at that really hard. And the audience realised that we dumped the rest, you know, the past, and but just carried on with the new invention of Status Quo. We dropped the, for some reason, our manager in the early days, so it ought to be called the Status Quo, which is not a good idea, Status Quo. So that's, you know, how it works. And also, don't forget, the songs were good. Yeah. As I said earlier about the songwriting, and also, the guys were good players, you know, they all gelled. We made sure that the bass guitar worked with the rhythm guitar, and the lead guitar worked with those guitars, and all the guitars worked with the drums, and the drums worked with the guitars. It was a formula that we worked on all the time, and it paid off, as you realise now.
Yeah, absolutely. It's great looking back, isn't it, to see the heady days of success, shall we say, because, you know, you playing stadiums and festivals and having that kind of adoration must have been quite an experience, to say the least.
Yeah, it was great. And of course, we did a lot of stuff at the Pops. Then we expanded. We got to go to Canada, the States, Scandinavia, all of Europe. We spread our wings and went on big tours. Then, you know, there's countries like Australia, New Zealand and Japan. We played down there a lot, and that was great. You know, it was really good to spread out. And but we tried to do well in America, because I think the way Fleetwood Mac did it the right way. I think they moved out there and just worked hard and played, because we were spoiled, because we thought, well, I think we did four or five tours in America. Some states were quite well known in other states, and they'd been heard of Status Quo. So it varied. I think we should have lived out there for a couple of years and worked hard, and hopefully it would have paid off, but it didn't, and we were spoiled, because we thought, we're England, we were very big in Europe, so we'll go back home and be rock stars there, you know, and that's how it turned out in the end.
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it, how the American market is so difficult, and it's a tough nut to crack for so many bands, isn't it? It's I think it's the size of it, I think, and the fact that they're all independent in states, and it works very differently to how it does over here in Europe, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah, I mean, America is very strange. It's in California we were great, and you go to Georgia, Atlanta. We played at Atlanta, Georgia for a week in this club called Richards. It was really good. Then you go to another state and no one's even heard of Status Quo or pictures of Matchstick Men. Then they come and watch us and go, oh, great. And but a lot of Americans used to hear us talking, and they say things like, oh, you guys from Australia? No, we're not Australia, we're from England. And they say things like, you're from England? Where? London, England. Oh, you must have met the Queen.
That's bad, isn't
why?
It?
Oh, you know. Yeah. Oh, no, I said, I've known the Queen, but we haven't met the proper Queen. No. And, you know, they were strange Americans, but, either they heard of you or they haven't. And I think a lot of it was fun, a lot of it was hard work.
Yeah, and I think that's the word there. It is hard work, and touring relentlessly like you did must have at some point got you down. And well, after 20 years you decided to quit, didn't you? What was behind that decision?
Well, I think we're in the studio, it was in Switzerland or something, recording, and I couldn't handle it anymore. I had a problem with the headset listening, and we weren't getting on, and I feel there was too many drugs, too much drink, there's lots of everything, and I just felt that I just had enough, threw a wad myself, you know, I can't do this. And most things would get blown over because it happens with bands all the time. And next thing is, there was a sort of chat, and what we should have done is taken a few months off, but of course we're in the studio at the time, it was awkward. So they just said, well, it's up to you, you know, whatever you do. But then I got on a plane the next day and flew home, took a year off.
Well, let's take a quick break now then, John, and just listen to a Quo track to take us back to those times. Anything you particularly want to hear?
I tell you what I do like, we don't hear much these days, is it's a Quo song, of course. It'll be Rick Parfitt singing Don't Drive My Car. I just think it's slightly different from the shuffle that all the Quo songs are. This is, when you hear it, you'll realise, but it is a sort of different tempo. And it's something, it's fresh and new. That's what I like about it. Hi, it's Johnny Coghlan here, and you're listening to Cat's Tales.
It sounds like it gets to a point where you've got to have a break, haven't you? And it was unfortunate timing, I think, that pushed you over the edge there, because as you say, if you weren't in the studio, it may have been a different story.
Yeah, I just thought if we'd taken 4 months off, say 5 months break, perhaps, took a big break, and had meetings talking about things, and, you know, we could have found out what was winding someone up or whatever. But, you know, the human body is great when it works well, and when it's overtired, very tired, it says, well, I've had enough of this. We just went on holidays, me and Julie. We just toured the world. When I say toured the world, we went with some nice places, but then I played with some other people, the Diesel Band. I played with a band called The Rockers. We made a single, an album, funny. It was called, there was Roy Wood, there was Chase Hodges, Phil Lynott and me, and we did a bit of stuff that wasn't promoted very well. But I played with loads of different musicians. I played with Noel Redding and Eric Bell, you know, all over the place, and blues clubs and things. But it was good because it was a change of procedure, and it really did me well.
Yeah, I can imagine that, because if you've been doing something for 20 years, you want that break. That's one thing, isn't it? But did it re-inspire you then to actually try and play the drums a different way, or, you know, take your career in a different direction because you had a different set of influences around you?
Well, I think one good band I had at the time was called Partners in Crime. It was a five-piece with keyboards and a guy called Noel McCullough, vocalist, wonderful, great singer, and CBS took us on and recorded up in Scotland, and it was great, good singles out, and but, you know, it was the same old story, you know, there's only so much we can do, and we weren't promoted very well, and I was living in the Isle of Man at the time, and because only 90 days a year you're allowed, if you're paying tax, 20% tax, or 15% what it was in the Isle of Man, and you're only allowed in the UK 30, was it 60 days a year or something like that? So you have to keep a track on that. And I just think it was, I was so used to things being done for us by the record company when I was with Quo. You get used to it. And of course, it was a totally different kettle of fish with Partners in Crime. You know, the record company hadn't pushed it hard enough. And whoever was managing the band at the time didn't. And because I think you get to the point where you think, do you know what? I've had enough of this.
Yeah, and it's a different sort of dynamic, isn't it, from the record label just doing it all and you just concentrating on the music and the lifestyle and the touring and keeping fit and whatever, to actually thinking, what's the bigger picture, and gaining skills that actually you don't necessarily want to be involved in.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. And I got into a bit of radio as well with BBC Radio Oxford and did some programmes for about 5 years. That was good fun. But it also, see, don't forget, it's like now, that stops everyone playing. And it's also when you come out of a big band and you're trying with another band, you come to a sort of heading where there's nothing going on. And you think, oh, God, what's happening? You know, are we going to push this even further? And if you're used to playing all the time, you get used to it and it's good fun. But when you're not playing and you're doing smaller gigs because the band's not famous, then you accept it and you think, well, OK, I don't mind, it's great. But you know, it is becoming hard work.
Yeah, it's a bit frustrating, isn't it, really? Because it's almost like going back to the beginning. But do you actually prefer those smaller audiences now? I mean, you're playing the same songs that you were when you were in Quo. So do you actually prefer the smaller, more intimate gigs than you were when you were on, you know, a big stadium stage?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I think most musicians would tell you that. I do, especially my band now. Of course, the gigs are smaller, but we love it because we filled them up, and there's nothing better than to see a nice gig fall to the brim, more or less sold out with your band, and it's a nice feeling, and the band love it, and of course everyone enjoys that. There's nothing worse for a fan to turn up at a gig and find out that he's, you know, the gig holds 1,000 people and there's only 300 in there or something like that, and everyone's spread out.
Yeah.
And I think it's like, oh God, you know. So it's a bit of a shame, but you need to promote these gigs. But the promoter needs to promote them. We need to do lots of radio interviews, do press interviews, get it out there so everybody knows that your band are playing it at that venue. So I think a lot of bands don't bother pushing. They just hope that everyone's going to turn up.
Yeah, absolutely, and it's hard work, isn't it? On the subject of hard work, John, you've chosen an instrument there that is extremely hard work, the drums. It's relentless, isn't it? You can't have a little bit of a break, can you, in a gig?
Well, what we do at all our gigs, we do 2:45s. We found out most gigs we play with my band, we do 3.5 hours. Now, what's happening, the gig itself is not drawing any money for the audience buying drinks in the interval. So what we did, we got booked back to loads of gigs through doing this, was the fact that when we play for 45 minutes or an hour, and take a 15, 20 minute break, all the audience go to the bar, have a drink, have whatever, and we have a drink backstage, we come back on, we're fired up, the audience are fired up, and we used to say things like, the more you drink, the better we sound, you know. So it was a bit of a joke, but, you know, they loved it. And people come up and we do a meet and greet at the end of the gig with autographs and pictures. And they love it because they say, well, John, thank you for me, you know, coming to see us. And thank you for allowing us to say hello and all that. And one guy said to me, do you know what, John? He said, it's great to see your band. He said, when I meet you, it's just like you're still in Status Quo, which was quite nice, really, you know, him saying that. And of course, I left in 81, which is a long time ago, but for some fans, it's like I'm still in the band.
Yeah, it's like time stands still, doesn't it, really, for some, you know. So why did you choose the drums in the first place then? Because, you know, it's a difficult instrument to play well. I mean, obviously all instruments are, but particularly the drums, because you have to keep up that energy level, don't you? You know, why did you choose it, and how do you keep up that sort of fitness level to be able to play them well?
Well, I just think it's, I remember in the early days, when I was a young lad, mum and dad would take me, they'd go ballroom dancing, and they used to take me along, and I'd sit and watch the drummer in the band, because it was dance bands in those days, I'm talking 60s, and I used to just watch, and I think, do you know what, I could do that, I reckon, anyway, yeah, it's much harder than I thought, of course. But if there's anything I can play, I can't play anything else, and drums is really good for me, and I love playing drums. And the way to do it is really relax, don't get tense, just using both feet and both hands, or playing four different rhythms at once to do it properly, and that's what I did. And it just seems a natural thing. Of course, I'm left-handed, but I play right-handed, so that's made things even complicated. And I suppose you could say I'm ambidextrous, but I can play drums the other way around. But all my power is in my left hand, so that's on the snare drum. So when I'm playing with the band, you know, the snare drum, it's just a twist of the wrist, really, going onto the snare drum, rim-shotting. And that's why it's loud, because I just do it naturally somehow, so that's how it's paid off for me.
Wow, that's really interesting, because, you know, those kind of nuances actually is the bit that's creating your distinctive sound, isn't it? And the thing that it makes me think about is when you're patting your head and rubbing your tummy.
I don't know, it's just one of those things I can do naturally without even thinking about it. And like I'm playing on the ride cymbal, just playing a shuffle or two to the bar on the bass drum, I can play fours on the left foot on the hi-hat. So that's got a little ching ring thing on top of it. So what I'm saying, you've actually got four different instruments playing at the same time, but sort of four different rhythms. So that's what I've achieved to do, and I enjoy that. It pays off, you know.
Yeah, that's amazing. That's really interesting to hear from me, John, as an observer. Amazing. Do you still keep in touch with Francis at all, or is that sort of a relationship that's, you know, dissipated over time?
Well, not really, because he's always working. If he's not working, he's doing his chat shows in each other's country. No, we don't really talk much. He's doing his thing, I'm doing mine, and Alan Lancaster doesn't get on with him either, so it's not too good at the moment. So, you know, one of those things, I'm afraid.
It is, isn't it, really? And I guess, you know, with Rick, you know, his passing, that changed things as well, didn't it, in terms of relationships?
Well, I think what Rick wanted to do was he wanted to carry on with us after the Frantic Four tour. He wanted to get another guitar to replace Francis, of course, but not many people knew that. But Rick wanted to do it, I wanted to do it, and Alan wanted to do it. But Francis wasn't interested. He said, why don't you do Status Quo PLC, which would be Status Quo Park at Lancaster and Coghlan. Mm. And it was talked about, but it never happened. Of course, then we know what happened to dear old Rick. He had an accident in Spain and fell over. And the rest is history.
Yeah, and that was the start of the troubles for him, wasn't it? Well, it would have been wonderful if we could have all seen that band, because that sounds like that would have been the one to see. So, not to be, unfortunately. And, of course, it won't be now, will it? But it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for your time, and you enjoy your day.
Thank you, Nine.
You've been listening to Cattails. To listen again to this and other tales, go to cattails.co.uk.